Joe Vitale, Richard Humann, and I heard about this project last week. Got an email about it from the contact I've worked with a few times before, from Ken about this project. I've worked with him on doing interviews with Frankie Previtt in the past, and hearing about this is a project I was not familiar with. How did you two get hooked up, Richard? How did you get Joe to do the engineering on this and describe this whole project, how this came together for this first song of the American Nomads?
Okay, well, I mean, it came about through Ken Franklin, who arranged this meeting with us as well. So we had been, we've worked in the past with a couple other producers and people who've worked with us mixing, and we've done a lot of stuff in-house also. And Ken kept talking about Joe Vitale, how amazing he is and how wonderful he is. And we know him obviously as a musician, of course, having played with so many people. And we're like, well, let's give it a shot. And the minute that Joe gave us the first cut back, the band fell in love with it and fell in love with working with Joe also. And it's not even because you're on the line. I'm saying this, Joe, it's the truth.
Okay. You can. Go ahead.
So anyway, that's how it came about. We through Ken, and the minute the first cut came back, the band just loved it. We're like, what an amazing sound you created, you know? And so we're looking forward to, as you know already, the next project, which will be around, well, we're starting it now. We're actually setting up the studio upstairs, the in-house recording studio. We moved it from one location to the other, a new location. We're if you hear clicking and banging and stuff, that's the guy setting up the studio upstairs. So we're ready for the next project to come about as well. That's how much we love working on Running on Empty Heart with Joe.
Nice. Joe, what was your familiarity with American Nomads and or when you heard, when you got called up for this project, what were your first thoughts hearing this, and especially getting the music to mix this all together? So basically your opinion on their music, what was your take?
Well, Ken Franklin had contacted me and said, hey, I'm working with this group and they've got some pretty cool songs. And would you be interested in they're looking for someone to mix. And I said, well, I don't just take jobs. I have to see what I'm doing first if I even want to take the job. So he sent me Ken, or one of the guys sent me a rough of it. And I just like just like Rich said, I fell in love with the song. I heard the song. I didn't know these guys, but I hear the song. I was like, wow, this is a good song. And I listened to what they had for the demo. And I right then I knew that I could make this thing sound really good. And I like working on music and that I like, I'll work on, I can work on projects that I don't like, but that's not fun, but I try not to do that. I like to work on projects that the music I can relate to and like, and I really fell in love with the music. I worked with the Eagles for a long time and it reminded me of something that they would do or should do or what have you. And I could really relate to the music and it just needed some tweaking and, a little bit of this and that and to get the mix happening. And we went back and forth a couple of times with try this, try that. And that's just that's the normal process. And all of a sudden I came to a mix that I really loved and they loved. And so that's it. And that's how it works. And I'm really excited about this next tune because it's an American anthem. It's going to be fabulous.
Is there go ahead, Richard, go ahead.
Oh, no, we're very excited too. And we're the last time, see, we had done a lot of the production before Joe came on to the last project. So we had it basically, produced out with Walter and Dante. Walter Kennel is one of the lead singers and the writer of the last two with me. I did the lyrics, Walter did the music and some of the lyrics too. This new one, we're bringing Joe in, or Joe's volunteering to come in from the very beginning. So even when we do rehearsal cuts, we send them those. So the last one was kind of like, here's the further stems, here's everything. See if you can make this sound great, which he did. And Joe also added this incredible guitar part to it that really brought this hook into the chorus section that Now that I hear it, I can't imagine the song without what Joe did with it. But the new version is, the new song is called My American Dream. And it's going to be, we're bringing Joe in from the very beginning. So he'll actually be producing it, not just engineer, mix, and master. It's going to be from the very beginning all the way through to the end.
Joe, what would you, or how would you describe your technique, your style when you're working in that regard behind the desk doing the engineering, especially in a modern context? And that's always something that it's kind of fun to talk about with other artists who've worked on this from the analog into the digital era and all the different technologies. What's your approach, especially with something that has a lot more musical heft, like something you're going to get from American Nomads? This is not like laptop, take a sample and just let it run. There's something, there's a lot going on there. So what do you do when you're trying to make it sound a certain way, like this particular, like these two particular projects?
Well, you know, right from the start, this is old school. This is beautiful. This is the way you make records, and it's not all computer generated and all that. This is real talent by people singing and playing. And I grew up making all these albums doing that. And I learned from some of the best producers and engineers in the world. And I mean, their credits are amazing. And these people knew what they were doing and still do. And so I learned from them that, you know what to look for. And we call it ear candy. We love that title, because that's what we call that when there's just something about a song that just grabs you and you love it. And it's hard to come by, you know, ear candy, we call it. And that's not always just little sparkly things that records, you know, you dress up records with. I'm talking about a vocal or a guitar part that just, oh, that thing is perfect. And so you look for that. And I found a lot of that. You know, I just mixed this song. What the guys did before I got my hands on it, they were already well into this great project. And I didn't really do much but mix it. But what they gave me was so fun to mix, because every track had something worthwhile. A lot of new artists that are just getting into recording, they don't realize, because computers have enabled groups to have, like, you need 50 tracks. Great. You got 50 tracks. You need 100 tracks. Great. You got 100 tracks. I grew up with, you got 16 tracks. Make the song work with 16 tracks. So, you know, we got into a place where, you know, it forced, like, people like Joe Walsh, it forced him to, it not forced, but it enabled him to, he had to come up with the killer rhythm guitar part, because, you know what, you only got two tracks. You don't have 20 tracks for guitar parts. So it made us think and create in a very special way, that everything we played meant something because we only had so many tracks. Well, the age of the computers changed all that, and it's not good, because it shouldn't change that in recording songs. It should be like, yeah, so what? You got 150 tracks if you want, but why don't you try making a record with 24? You know what? You'll make a great record with 24. And when you think about it, when you think about rock and roll, in all the genres of rock and roll, when you think about it, you really don't need more than 24 tracks, really. Because when you look at the drums and the bass and the keys, guitars, vocals, it's all possible on 24 tracks. And what happens is a lot of people make use of, like, you know, 50, 60 tracks, and they just water down the production. They water it all down. There's so many things going on. There's phase problems. There's all kinds of technical problems going on. And there's not one thing that you can, your ears can focus on, other than the vocal, maybe, but there's not one thing musically that you can focus on that really, you know, it's hard to play air guitar to these new songs. And a lot of kids, you know, a lot of people do. They love that. What's cool about all the records I made is there's always been a great guitar player on the record. And people, you know, are standing there with an invisible guitar in their hands, make them believe they're playing those parts. And that's really exciting to me. And so back to what we were talking about with the American Nomads song, you know, they had that, they had this great, the drums part, I'm a drummer. The drum part was killer. It was just like train, this like this soft train that went through the whole song, and just such nice energy. And so my cat's once cat would get in on it. It was a pleasure to mix it, because it was really reminded me of all the records I ever made.
Richard, you're the lyricist for American Nomads.
I write about the majority of the lyrics, yes. Okay. I mean, George LaGrange throws in when he writes a song, Walter sometimes, but the majority of the lyrics, yes, I do the majority of them.
Where have you gotten your inspiration for writing lyrics for songs? I mean, you've got a whole lot of artistry going on, obviously. But for this particular segment of your art, where do you find that particular tap, or where do you tap into for that inspiration?
It comes from different places, right? Joe was just talking about like multi-track recording systems, and I agree with him, by the way, to go back for a second. I agree. I think that like when people are doing 50, 60, 100 tracks, I don't like the sound of that music. Whereas George Martin did Sgt. Pepper on 8 tracks, I believe, right? And the tie-in of what you're talking about is, so my inspiration will come in maybe like Lennon on Sgt. Pepper with, being for the benefit of Mr. Kite. Goes in somewhere, sees a poster, reads those words, and all of a sudden this song develops. So sometimes I'm reading a book, or sometimes I'm on the subway. I live in Brooklyn. We all live in Brooklyn. We live in an old firehouse here. The band, Walter owns it, and we rehearse here, and I've been living here for many years. And I'll be on the subway, see some words, or like an inspirational hit me. And I tend to build out from the story, whereas like Running on Empty Heart, Walter and I will do a lot of writing together. He's like, I have this idea for this melody. Can you throw words to it? And sometimes I'll put words and George or Walter will put the melody down. But he had this idea for that song. And he's like, and I the chorus is Running on an Empty Heart. And I was like, oh man, I love that. I just loved it. And then we just started telling the story. So I just, basically telling a story about the twisted road and no amends, and so it's basically, it's a narrative in short form is what it is. And of course, being a writer, because I write as well as regular poetry, songs have a structure. You've got verse structure, you've got a bridge structure, and you've got a chorus structure. So you're plugging this creativity into a set structure that's happening. You could break that, structure where, Stone Temple Pilots with Plush, every aspect of that song is like a chorus, right? There are verses and bridge and so pre-chorus, but everything is this incredible chorus. But we tend to write verses, chorus, verse, chorus, bridge, back and out. So you have to plug into that. But my inspiration literally comes from everywhere. Lots of reading, lots of just observing. And I constantly take notes down as well. A great phrase or something. A lot of songs start with a great phrase that I've read or heard somewhere.
Do a crossover between some of your specialties. So, Joe, which lyricists of any sort throughout the history, pop, rock, whatever musical genre, which lyricists really stand out as your favorites all time?
Wow. I probably have quite a few, but, I loved a lot of the lyrics that Bernie Taupin did with Elton. I mean, what a great lyricist. I mean, that's a team right there. Of course, Lennon McCartney, forget about it. That there was some great lyrics there, and eternal lyrics. But and one thing I must say about what Rich said about writing, this is why he writes really good words, because he takes real life experience. And there's nothing better than taking real. I mean, I think I truly believe the only writers that were ever able to sell a fantasy as far as, lyrics about nothing that's real, just something, were the Beatles. Like, there were lyrics that they wrote that never happened. That didn't happen, but they were so interesting, and they were able to pull it off. But obviously the best songs that live forever are songs with real life experiences, because the listener can relate to it and they feel that. And, mm-hmm. and so when Rich was talking about, he's out and about and in the subway, wherever, and you get these images. And one thing I learned about those kind of songs is that you know, you need in your lyrics, you paint a picture. It's all about images, and people really relate to that. And I don't know any other way to define it that, you know, if you're going to write a song and it has moments of, you know, real heartfelt moments. Well, most of those heartfelt moments comes from the words you're singing, and people can relate to them, and they could be happy or sad, but they can relate to them. They're human, and they, you know, and that's the way to write songs. It's life's experiences. And it's, you're taking a chance if you write a song about something you've never experienced. It's really rough. It's hard. You can do it if you're literally, if you're that bright that you can actually create an experience and write about, but it's not the same as you actually lived it, because then you get passion.
I agree. And there's an expression that I try to live by with all my writing, which is, you know, no tears for the writer, no tears for the reader, right?
Exactly. So, perfect.
And so for me, it's the same thing. Yes, one of our songs is called Three Steps to Jesus, right? Which is, that's more of a fun thing. That hasn't been released yet. We've been working on it. We've played it live, but nothing on an album yet. And a guy that we were, an elderly gentleman I know in the business, manager for a very big act, he got sick. This is pre-COVID. And he's like, oh, guys, listen, I'm back today, but I was three steps from Jesus just a few weeks ago. And I was like, I'm stealing that. So sometimes you can steal things like that. But the truth is, no tears for the writer, no tears for the reader. So I try to make it something that I feel in my heart or I can experience. And I want you to experience it with me.
Interesting. Now, the other way around, Richard, your most admired, most favorite instrumentalist, and Joe is primarily a drummer, but you could choose any musical instrumentalist in any musical genre.
It's tough, right? Just Joe said this stuff too, like lyrically, it's how do you pick, right? Do you pick, Bernie Taupin? Do you pick, Bob Dylan or whomever? So musically, I'd have to say, believe it or not, guitar-wise, would be David Gilmour. And I was lucky enough to meet David, 10, 15 years ago, backstage at one of the Pink Floyd shows. But this guy I just look up to, and he's not a guy like a Stevie Ray Vaughan or a Eric Clapton that could just bang out thousands of notes per beat. He's a guy that makes one, maybe the lead, seven notes the whole lead, but you feel every single nuance of that lead. So I'd have to say he's one of my favorite of all time, you know, drummer wise, other than Joe Vitale, of course, is maybe like, of course, everybody goes to Bonham or Ringo. I happen to like Ringo. I love Ringo's drumming. I think that it's such a unique kind. Yeah, it's incredible.
Musical drummer. Yeah, I love him. Anytime I've ever been in a band that did some covers or playing at a club somewhere, sitting at a club and you play a Beatles song, if you're a drummer and you play a Beatles song, I'm sure it's the same thing if a guitar player or bass player, but if you're a drummer and you play a Beatles song, you realize what a genius he was. His parts were, they seem simple. They're not simple. They're just, they're the perfect drum part for that song.
I totally agree. I can get lost sometimes. I can go down a rabbit warren of watching like drum covers of Beatles songs where it's just a guy, it's not Ringo, but it's a guy with GoPro camera set up drumming to a Beatles song. And you realize, nobody else does that, you know.
Nobody played like that.
Nobody.
And you know, one thing people don't realize, and I've researched this to death, and I hope somebody corrects me. But so far, I've been researching it for years. Nobody's ever corrected me. Okay. Ringo Starr was the first drummer to play matched grip. That means he held the sticks the same in both hands, other than the traditional jazz guys, with a left hand or right hand, depending what you were, was a different grip than, you know. And he was the first drummer to have matched, and I remember in 64 when I saw the Beatles, my father was a musician. So when I saw the Beatles, I started playing like matched grip like that. My father said, "You're not holding your drumsticks right."
Right.
I said, "Wait a minute." I said, "Ringo holds them like this. That's right. It's right."
Exactly. And I think you're right. I think in one of those rabbit holes I was down recently, a drummer, and I don't know who it was talking about the matched grip like that and mentioned that he got that from Ringo as well.
So I asked Ringo about it. I when I was with him, I said, who showed you this? He said, I don't know. He said, when I decided to play drums one day, I picked up a pair of sticks and that's how I held them and played. I said, well, you know, you created this whole thing. The drummers play match script now. Now, a lot of jazz guys play traditional because the nature of the playing, it's actually a little better to have a traditional grip like that. But right. I said, man, you created something that every drummer in the world, you know, tries now, it wants to do. And pretty amazing. He wasn't that impressed with himself about it. I mean, he just said, that's the way I picked up sticks and played. So I said, more power to you, man.
That's amazing. It's amazing.
Wow. Did not know that. That's really cool. I got two historical questions, one for each of you about work you've done. As long as I've got you here on a Zoom, so I'm going to take advantage of this. I'll start with you, Joe. If I read the credits right, you were the drummer for Southern Cross?
Yes.
Okay. And I mentioned that because that was one of my late father's absolute favorite songs. I remember hearing that as a kid, and it takes me back every time I hear it. If we play it here on the radio, I get flashbacks to the autumn of 1982 hearing that on the radio. So as long as I've got you here on a Zoom, I got to ask you, what are your memories of recording that song?
Oh, I got a great memory of recording that song. First of all, that's one of my favorite. I recorded about 100 CSN songs, CSNY, whatever. But that, out of all those tunes, that's one of my favorite as well. It was one of those songs that was perfect. The feel was perfect. The vocals are stunning. The words are great. Everything about that song was great, you know? But the one thing I remember that not anybody knows this, you know, but once the inside information on it was this, that was take one. When we cut that song, we learned it. We heard Steven sit down with his acoustic and he played the song and sang it. And again, that's also the way you really write good songs. You're able to sit down with an instrument and play and sing it, even though it's rough. That's how you know it's a good song. Anyway, he played it for us and we go, oh, this is great. Let's do it. We got on our instruments. We put it, you know, roll the tape. And because we knew what we were doing, we just hit it right off the bat. And when we were done, the engineer was in there. He was jumping up and down and controlling. He says, come on in, guys. We got it. And we're like, what? What was we just learning? We walked in there and we went, it's it's perfect. Take one on that song.
Amazing.
Wow. That's.
Yeah. That's, I mean, and then the guys went out. And old-fashioned, old style, the three of them stood around one mic, not individual tracks, one mic, double tracked it, and there's your vocal.
Oh my gosh.
the way we used to control blends back then was, you know, if you each guy was on one mic, one track, one channel, one fader, then you'd move the faders. That's not the way they did it. There's a certain magic to the blend if you're all around one mic. And the way you control the blend is the engineer says, hey, Crosby, step back 6 inches. That's how you did it. You know, and you didn't have to worry about faders. And then he would hear in there when all of a sudden that magic would happen, that blend. And that's the way we did it back then. And I'll tell you what, I love a lot of the new technology. I love the computer stuff is killer. It's great. It's fun. Great editing. That's for sure. But I'll tell you what, I would have never had it any other way, but to grow up the way I did and learn the stuff I did with old school recording, because that process is still today. The only thing that's changed is the media and what you're recording to. Although I'll always think that tape sounds better than digital. A lot of people say that. I think it does. But really, the process is pretty much the same.
Richard, in your case, I got a note from Ken, which is what prompted this question, that said you worked with Bob Defren
back. Yeah, Bob was I came to New York in 1985 after college, and I was doing working in a type shop. I was always a designer. And then in 1992, I broke out on my own and as a designer. And Bob was one of my first clients with Atlantic Records. So Bob is known as the guy that he designed the AC/DC logo, which Bob always says they're going to end up putting that on his tombstone because that's what he's going to be remembered for. You know, the AC/DC logo on Bob's tombstone. But I worked for Bob. I did Atlantic Records. I also worked with MTV, Nickelodeon, VH1. So I did a lot of work in the music business.
What? knowing that now, especially all of those networks, and I mean, back then I was watching a lot of those networks, especially MTV, VH1, back when they played videos, you know, back in that era.
Yeah, exactly. That's when I was part of it. Yeah.
What was your most favorite project to work on in that era among some of those entities you just mentioned?
Well, you know, it's hard to say because I remember we did an AC/DC. Bob was doing something with AC/DC. I think it was one of their later ones, you know. I mean, I like AC/DC. I'm not a rabid fan per se, but it was like either Ball Breaker, I think it was. And I just remember like having to contact people. And I think they had just come off tour, so they were all tired of each other. One was in Australia, one was in England, one was out in LA. And if one person liked something, the other one vehemently denied that that's ever going to happen. So I remember that process. They were like, you know, like arguing amongst each other. But
that's a real band.
Exactly.
That's a real band.
We're the same way, trust me. But I think in those days, everything was bigger than life with MTV when I was there, or Atlantic too. You just knock stuff off. I mean, I live in Brooklyn, but I have a house in Woodstock. And it's because of those days, I bought that house because of the money generated by doing 24 hours a day for years straight with all those companies. But one of my favorite MTV moments was they did a Christmas party, and I think it was at Lincoln Center, and they got Eric Clapton played it. He introduced From the Cradle at that party. So he came out and he performed at the MTV party there. So, I mean, that's what it was like back in those days, you know, to be at a party and Clapton's doing From the Cradle originally by himself, like kind of like the Talking Heads where David Byrne walks out by himself a couple songs and the band joins slowly. And that's what Clapton did From the Cradle. And I just never feel like, now that's a Christmas party.
You know? Wow. Wow.
Yeah. Oh
my gosh. What an era. Well, we got you guys working together and more to come. And that's great with all of your assorted artistry coming together. There's going to be more to come. I'm glad that I got the chance to talk to you guys. And again, what was the name of the new song that's going to be coming out?
My American Dream.
Okay. We'll look for that coming. You got a ballpark estimate on when it might
get? Because it's like this Americana anthem, we're going to shoot for the week or two before the 4th of July, have it as a 4th of July release, have it up available about a month ahead of time, I would say.
Very good. And Running on an Empty Heart, that's the one you can listen to right now. Joe Vitale, Richard Humann, thank you both for taking some time to chat today. This has been a very fun half hour.
Oh, thanks. Thank you so much. I hope we can do it again. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Thanks, Luke. Take care. Bye now.
Yeah, you too. Bye-bye.